And I had to go to work awfully young, so I didn't get very much education. But you know, I was very fortunate. I went to work for the telephone company and I had to lie about my age to get a job, but I had to have a job. Mother wasn't able to support us. And I had a boss that liked me, and she just gave me a promotion every year until I was chief operator there for 14 many years. And that was a big office. I worked over about 200 girls.
200 girls? Mm-hmm. Quite a big office.
Yes, it was. But it was Tulsa. And Harley worked with a long distance group, and I worked with a local group, but I had a better job than she did. Don't ever mention it to her. Probably is. She probably isn't very happy about it.
Is there anything I can do to help you get set up there?
No, I'm ready now.
Okay.
Okay. Thank
you.
I'll
just stay out of your way.
Ma'am, what's your full name?
Beth Meeks.
Beth Meeks. Beth Thomas Meeks.
Beth Thomas Meeks. I wish I could see as good as you can.
Okay, today is June 27th, 1988.
Am I showing too much leg here?
Oh, no, ma'am. June 27th, 1988. My name is Joe Todd, and this is an interview with Mrs. Beth Thomas Meeks in Norman, Oklahoma. Ma'am, where were you born?
I was born in Guthrie, when it was the capital.
And when's your birthday?
June the 21st. They had a lot of this stuff come due on my birthday.
And what year were you born?
1899.
Who was your father?
Beth Thomas.
Beth Thomas.
It was Henry Andrew, was his full name.
And your mother?
Madie Mowdry.
I'm sorry?
Madie Mowdry. She was a minister's daughter.
How do you spell the last name?
M-O-W-B-R-A-Y. They came over from England.
And where was your father born?
Athens, Georgia.
When did your father first come to the territory?
Did you know that he wasn't old enough to be a soldier in the Civil War? But on the side of the South, he went as a courier when he was 12 years old. And he took a 12-year-old colored boy with him. And they fought through they worked through the war. They couldn't be a regular soldier, but they did. I know that one thing that he did, he has an uncle that's buried over here at Kiowa. And he was a general on the southern side. And he's buried over there. My husband and I went one time and searched, and we had to search a long time, but we found that grave. And they had a great big lot that was enclosed with a wire fence, and they had a crypt of a thing that he was buried in, made of cement. And they didn't have on there that he was a general, because they lowered their rank. After it was over, I guess it was on account of pensions and things. I don't know why they did that, but they showed on his tomb that he was an ex-rate lower, and I don't know how they rated him. I don't know what that was now. I did know. I don't know whether it tells on the picture or not. I took a picture.
What was his name?
I've got it in. If if I can find that right quick. I've got it in a little book.
Tell me some more stories about your father as a courier in the Civil War.
When he was 13 years old, he ran in the dark. He ran across a tent that they were using for operations where they amputated legs and arms. And he said that he stepped off in this almost to his waist. He was just a kid. He had this darky boy. And it just shocked him to death. He wasn't a scary person at all. He was brave as all get out. But I know one thing that he was proudest of during the things that he did there. He, there was a general on the southern side named, I believe, Kearney was his name, I believe. And he had such a beautiful, beautiful mare. And his uncle used Papa to take that horse home to his wife after the man was killed. And he was proud of that, I know. But he wasn't injured, but he got sick over there. Had, I don't know what it was that he had, typhoid or what, but his father was injured. And he was injured bad. I believe that he died soon, pretty young. I believe that's right. I never did see my grandparents on the other side. See, both of them married twice. And I'm the youngest one on the second side, the second go round.
So when did your father come to the territory here, do you remember?
I came with him when I was 2 years old. And I lived with him in that tent, and my sister and mother.
Now you were born in Guthrie?
I was born at Guthrie, and you know that house is still over there in the parade of homes for the territories, and they still, I forget what they call those, I didn't know, and I've been in it since I've been grown.
When did your father leave Georgia and come to Oklahoma?
I don't know. That was so long before my time that it doesn't stay with me. It was before I married my mother.
How old were you when you left Guthrie and went to Lawton?
2 years old.
2 years old. Could you give me a description of Lawton in those early years? What the town looked like?
It was a mess. I've got pictures and things. It was a mass of people and just living in the worst possible circumstances. And none of us had houses yet. And Papa lived in a tent for a while, and then he rented a house for somebody for a while. It was Al Jennings' house. You know who Al Jennings was? He was an old ribstick. He wasn't any good. No possible good. And then Papa was building a house. It wasn't much of a house either. We just had to get by with what we could get, you know, in those days. It was just a mess. And we lived on South Boundary and 2nd Street. Way out to the edge of town.
That's in Lawton.
Uh-huh.
Was this for the land opening, 1901?
No, it was just after.
Well, you went to Lawton just after the great lottery then?
He was down there. Papa was over there during the lottery. I don't know whether he took us over there then or just probably a little later, I'd imagine.
Would you describe life in a tent?
Well, I'd kind of have funny ideas because it was a baby. I was just a baby. But it didn't bother me any to live in a tent because everybody else was living in them too, and I was just a baby. It didn't register with me. And as long as I was with my dad and my mother, why, that was my whole world. But it was primitive, boy. Awfully primitive. And it was down there where they had the courthouse later, you know, the courthouse square. And as I told you, we lived next door to Senator Gore. I don't know whether he moved in first or we did, but we lived there. And I've got a letter in this great big scrapbook that I have of my father's. And my mother, that was the one thing that I asked her for when she asked me what she had that I'd like to have. And she didn't have anything really that I wanted. I'd been helping her. And I said, Mother, there's only one thing that I want, and I want it real badly on the scrapbook. And she says, well, it's yours. Take it home with you. And my sister wasn't very happy about it, but don't put that in, because her son wanted it. But Mother gave it to me, and I've got it, and I'm leaving it to Dorothy Bell.
What kind of man was Senator Gore? Would you?
I couldn't pass an opinion, but my father held him in the highest regard. The highest regard. And he has a letter in there from Senator Gore, and it was an awfully nicely written thing. And he was high on my father. He loved him. You know, did you know how Senator Gore lost his eyes? That's not that kind of a part. He played baseball. He loved to play baseball. And he got his first eye put out when somebody hit him in the eye with one. Well, he didn't quit playing. He kept on playing. He was a lawyer. And he got hit in the other eye and was blinded. Well, how he could be a lawyer and keep up with the law and everything, I don't know, but he did. And he wrote a beautiful letter. And he showed his regard for my father in that letter.
Do you remember that first election when he ran for senator? Do you recall that? That was 1970.
You mean Gore?
Yes, ma'am.
I was still remembering.
Do you remember staging that day?
Yeah.
Tell me about that day.
Well, I was still awfully immature, but so I don't remember too much about it. But they were going and coming, right and left. I'll tell you, it was just a disorganized in my mind.
Did your dad take you up on the train?
Huh?
Didn't your dad take you up on the train? I think he took you from Lawton up to Guthrie on the train, didn't he?
Well, something was said somewhere in the book, in the scrapbook, about that was one of the happiest days of his life, the day he took Harley and I up to Oklahoma City. But you know, I'm not sure that he did, that he took us up there. There's a doubt in my mind about it, really. But we were up there later.
What kind of man was your father?
Oh, he was the greatest. There was another one like him. He was the kindest, sweetest man I ever knew. Did you know that he was called to the ministry in the beginning, back there when he was young, when he'd been out of the war just a while? And something happened within the church. It was a Methodist church in Atlanta, Georgia. Not Atlanta, but it was in Georgia. My mind didn't work as fast as it used to. There was a college there in this big town. That's where he went, was going to school. Well, anyway, the preacher and one of the members of the choir decided to have a romance. Well, it just disgusted him so bad that he left the church and never did go back. And he would have made a beautiful preacher. He believed in the Lord. I'll tell you, the biggest mother was a preacher's daughter. But she never did give me any religious training. What I got on my own later. I mean, I got it good and deep. And studied and I taught and I taught and I taught for all these 56 years. But, and I loved it. I loved every minute of it. I've just been out of it 2 years. But I just, it came to play. Well, of course, my eyes have entered into it now. I could do it if I wanted to. But as far as knowledge and all else, I've got it. Well, what did I start to tell you? The most Christian training that I got, my father had a very beautiful voice, singing voice. And he would sit and he spent an awful lot of time with me. And if I ever amount to shucks, it would be because of the training and things that he gave me. And he would sit and sing hymns to me for the hour. He had a beautiful voice. And he was always wanting me to sing second, and I don't have any music much in me. And I wouldn't try to sing with him very much, but I'd listen to him. And he just contributed an awful lot to my life. And I just made up my mind that if anybody was ever going to live decent, I was going to live decent, and I did. And I was only 12, or I just barely was 13 by a month, I think, when he died. And
how did he die?
Huh?
How did he die?
In the bed. He'd been in bed for a year, and, you know, he was the volunteer fire department chief, and also the first city chief of police there in Lawton, the first one. And he was running to this volunteer fire. And he was a tall man. He was 6 feet tall. And he was running, and this was a little old cart of a thing that they drug. And he was running with that. And he caught his toe on something, and it just laid him out flat. And it bursted the mitral valve in his heart. And he never was well anymore. And I think he lived 7 years, but he was sick the whole time. But he kept up and kept going until right there at the last year, he was that fast.
What kind of personality did your father have?
Oh, he's very soft-spoken and sweet and gentle. I never heard him swear but once in my life. And I can remember yet, just like it just happened. He had a great big old rock in his hand. I don't know, he was going to put it over against his horse pen or cow pen, whatever it was. He kept them both in there, I think. And he was carrying it, and he wore those shoes that have soft toes down here, and they wouldn't be a bit of support if anything had fallen on it. Probably wouldn't anyway. And he was carrying this thing, and it slipped out of his hand, and oh, it just smashed his toe off on one foot. And he said, "Well, Jesus H. Christ." And that's the only time in my life I ever heard him use a swear word. He didn't swear, but that was a special occasion, and I didn't laugh. I knew better than to laugh. He wouldn't have said anything ugly to me if I hadn't, but I didn't want to embarrass him anyway.
Now, your father was a U.S. Marshal.
Yes.
Do you have any recollections of things that happened while he was a Marshal?
Yeah. He used to take me uptown with him a lot. We had horse and buggy. We didn't have cars in those days. And he used to take me uptown with him, and when he went without me, I would be watching for that. It was a big old long dirt road, 2nd Street, and I'd be watching down 2nd Street to see him come. And I said, "Here comes Papa," and I'd go spattering up there in the hot mud and dirt, whatever, to meet him. But I just worshipped him, really. Worshipped him more than I did God at the time. I didn't know God. But he gave me an awful lot of things to think about through my young days and adult days and stuff. And I've lived a decent life.
When was your father first appointed U.S. Marshal?
Now that would be in this book, but it was when he first went, pretty close as after he went there. Have you ever been in this a museum there at Lawton?
The Fort Sill Museum?
No, Fort Sill doesn't use it. It's a public.
Oh, okay.
And it's a nice building. I went down to, for the dedication. I've got a whole bunch of pictures of that in there in the scrapbook. And different people that we knew there at Lawton, and they had, would you like to see it?
Well, as we get through the interview, I'd like to see it.
The thing's heavy. I can't hardly lift it.
Yeah.
But in there, they had different things fixed in kind of blocks around this thing. It was pretty nice. And it is nice. And they had this dedicated especially to him, this one particular block. And they had other Chris Madsen's in there, and I don't remember who else. I was there in there last decoration day, I think. Was it last decoration day we were down there, Dorothy? Do you think it has? Well, anyway, they had Chris Madsen's picture in there with him, and they had some more. And they just had Papa as the big star of the thing, and then they had ribbons or some kind of markers that ran out each one of the names of these other marshals that they. And I know Uncle Chris was one of them. They didn't have near all of them, but some of them. And what was I going to tell you? But this one was especially his. And they had one of his guns and a rifle in there and different things.
Why was the family living in Guthrie when you were born?
Well, he was a law officer there. That's why.
And then why did the family move to Lawton?
Well, he was going over there to help with this new town. It was a great big lot of excitement all over. And so he was the first marshal to be sworn in there. And he served for 7 years, I believe, if I'm right about that. And then after he had this accident, he had to slow down to a walk. Do you know the one thing that he did that I'm not going to tell about? Maybe he wouldn't want me to.
I'll turn it off.
Well, then you can put it back on if you want to.
Okay.
He still had some of the little boy in him. He loved to buy chickens. And he had some real fancy game chickens. And all of his partners around there fought them too. John Lansmaster and all of the fellows that worked with him. He just loved to do it. And
about the chickens, the gaming chickens?
Well, they were fancy roosters. And he'd get out there in the barn, and I was always with him, no matter where he was, I was there, if it was possible. And I was out there with him while he was working on his chickens and training them. And he had a big old long platform of a thing. He couldn't drive a nail straight. But I don't know whether he put this together or not, but I've seen some of his carpenter work, and I can't drive a nail straight either, but I believe I could bring her out distance him, but he just couldn't drive a nail. But anyway, he'd made this big long thing to, and he cooked meat, roast beef and stuff, and ground it up. And then he'd get this rooster and get his hands under his wings here, and he'd just run him up and down this thing and then bring him back and do him again. He was trying to make his legs strong, you know. They fight with these gabs on there, on the thing that's, what is this, the spur that sticks out on their ankle or whatever you call that, on their leg. And he'd run that thing up and down, up and down, up and down. And I'd stay out there with him while he was training him. And he just liked to have me around him. And I liked to be around him, so we'd go along fine.
Chris Manson. Tell me about
I don't know whether Uncle Chris ever fought the chickens or not.
Let me try this. There.
I don't know whether Chris Madsen ever fought the chickens or not.
What kind of man was he?
Well, he was a real fine, good man. A genuine gentleman. You could just count on at the last ditch, and so was Bill Tillman. And they were, we called them uncle. It was Uncle Bill and Uncle Chris. I've got a little set of silverware in there that Bill Tillman gave me when I was just a little bit of a thing. And I've still got it. But they called, we always called them Uncle Bill and Uncle Chris. And they just made over like we were their own children. And Papa thought a lot of their children. Uncle Bill helped them put them. Uncle Bill had some boys that were bad boys. And one of them went to jail. But Madsen's kids were fine. They were just different time.
What kind of man was Chris Madsen? What kind of personality did he have?
Well, you know, you knew he was a Dane, and he was educated with the King of Denmark. But he was very, very well educated. He wrote the most beautiful hand, and Reno did too. I used to get letters from him until he stayed over there too long, and I was engaged with him, so I didn't put that in there either. But, he was a real fine man. I believe he's dead now. But he was a real fine, Uncle Chris was just a real fine man. You couldn't ask for, he was a strictler for being honest and good.
Was he soft-spoken like your father?
Well, not so much. He spoke with all of this accent. Would you like to have a little funny thing between the two men? Papa had a lovely mare, and he had a buggy, and we used to go with that all the time. Well, he took Chris, and they were going somewhere, and his horse and buggy, and there'd been a big rain, and there was quite a bit of water in this little squaw creek down just below our house. And when they were going across this water, they had to go down into the water to get across. And Uncle Chris's hat blew off. And so Papa suggested that he stand on this round thing, you know, the wheel is fastened to. What do you call that? Anyway, the wheels of the buggy were fastened onto this thing on under the buggy. And so he suggested Uncle Chris that he put his foot on this side of this round thing. Put the other one over here just inside of the body of the buggy. And just as soon as he got situated, Papa just pulled off the reins loop and said, "Whoa, Dally," and it just threw Uncle Chris headlong in this water. They just threw lots of jokes on each other. And it just soaked him and got his hat all wet. He said, "Now heck, look what you went and done." And he spoke with an accent, a strong one. "Look what you would have done." And it was just too funny for words, and we all just died. And he went on like he didn't do it on purpose, but he did, and I know him.
What about Bill Tillman?
He was a real sweet, fine man. I liked him. I just liked him. But they used to play all kinds of pranks on each other. Do you want one on Tillman? Papa and Bill Tillman were out chasing outlaws. Were out on away from home. And there was a girl that kept happily shining up to Uncle Bill, and didn't mean anything. He was just eating in the restaurant. I don't know whether I ought to tell this one. What? Well, anyway, after they left the restaurant, Papa made a little talk to him, and he told him that he knows this girl was interested in him, but he wasn't going to be casual. But he made him think that she was interested and she liked to date him. And so up on top of. I think that he said something to the girl. Anyway, he was trying to halfway cook up something. And so he didn't take Papa with him. But when he went out, when he thought he was going to meet the girl, he went himself. And there was a park there, a place where they had trees and plant stuff, you know, and benches. And Uncle Bill went there and sat down, and he waited. He'd get up and walk a while, turn around, walk back the other way. And she didn't come. So he was just about to lose patience. Papa could see he was back there in the bushes, hiding. And after when Uncle Bill was just about to get him out, Papa stepped out. And Uncle Bill knew immediately what he'd done. And he stepped out and he just gave Papa Hail Columbia, happy land. But Papa got a laugh out of that. But they played lots of practical jokes on each other all the time. And he used to bring them down to our house to eat. My mother was a real good cook, not a Southern, but an English cook. And he was always bringing them down there to eat, and his friends too. He brought lots of people to eat.
When did you start school?
When?
Yes, ma'am. When and where?
Well, I started school at Lawton there. But I took a disease the first year, my first year at school, and I had to drop out. I just had fever all the time, and they never could find out what was the matter with me. So I didn't get to go to the first year. So I started to the first grade when I was 7. I didn't get to have a great deal of education, but my folks were both educated, and that helped me. And mother was she taught school too. Did you know that? She taught school in the mission school. My grandfather was a missionary from England, and he came from Melton Mowbray over there. And grandmother came with a fine family, this Harley family over there. And mother had a wonderful, wonderful memory. I never saw anything like it. And I've had a pretty good one, but it isn't anything to what hers was. And my grandfather was that way. But she did a real good job, but she only taught, a couple of years maybe, and then she was teaching for the mission school, you know. And she had a few kids in there that were pure Indian. And one little boy, he was young, he was spelling dog. And he said, D-O-G, Ifa. That's the Indian pronunciation. And she'd tell what little funny things that the kids had done and said after I was older. But I guess she was a pretty good school teacher, but to be so young, she wasn't. See, she had hair. She didn't have so much education, but she was pretty bright. My grandfather was too, but I didn't like him. I hope that isn't on there. I didn't like him.
What was the name of the school when you started?
I don't remember. I got a book from my sister. Dorothy? You remember that last book that we got from Harley about the, it was on that preacher in Tulsa, and I told you that I had been in their congregation. You don't remember the name of the preacher or the book?
No.
I bet you I'm always loaning the books loosely. I don't remember saying it, do you? Would you look under the table over here, Dorothy, and see if it's in there? I don't know whether you ever read that one or not. I doubt if you did. It wasn't too interesting. Well, it was too, in a way. I'm sure that it told the name of the school in there.
As a small girl, what chores did you do around the house?
Oh, I helped with the dishes. And I'd go and get the water, and I'd put the milk out. We had a big tray of the thing in the well house, and it was cold in there. And she kept milk and cottage cheese and stuff down the cellar. It was cement. And she'd send me to get those things. She'd send me to the store for odds and ends. We feed the dog. We always had a dog. And it still lasts with me. Well, I didn't kill myself. So I don't know. She didn't ask an awful lot. We didn't ever cook when I was little.
What type of house did your father build in Lawton?
Oh, it was pretty sorry. It was just a poor old house. Just, and you know, they painted it with this little barn red like they put on old depots and things like that. But they painted it that color of red to start with. It was, I think we had five rooms. And there was one little room off the side that she called her summer kitchen, and she'd cook with coal oil out there on that. But we cooked with coal in the house and heated with coal. We had this real good storm cellar. We had lots of storms at Lawton. And it pretty always came on my birthday, on the 21st of June. That's the longest day of the year. And they pretty always have a little birthday party for me and have school kids down and all. And every time there'd be a storm, the pop would be just a racing through the town taking kids home. We had a good cellar.
Your father built the cellar?
No, he hired it built. He wasn't much of a farmer, the builder thing. And it, like I told you, he couldn't drive a nail straight. But he'd build his chicken coops and things. He didn't do the loveliest tailor job.
What was your water supply?
We had the best well of water you ever tasted down there. We pumped it and had a pump. He had this little kind of a lattice house. We had two of them. We had one that was round that had vines and flowers and things on it in the front of the lot. And then right out opposite the kitchen, he had this larger one. And he had a galvanized iron tray at the bottom of it, and he'd keep water going in that. And they'd keep the milk and the water and things cold in there. But if they had something that needed to be kept real, real cold, well, they'd keep it in the cellar where it was cold down there. It was all finished good inside.
How far was the well from the house?
Oh, 57.5 feet.
And did you live in Lawton itself, or did you live out in the country?
In town.
In town.
We lived right at the edge of town. You know, I noticed that I told you that we lived on second and south boundary. And the south boundary was the edge of town. And we just lived, it was like this. The road was between us and the country, and we kept our cow over there in that place I used to go and get the cow to bring her in to milk.
Just one cow?
At first we just had one. Later on we had two. We were poor as Job's turkey because Papa had been sick so long, you know, and Mother did the milking of the cow. He couldn't do anything very hard. After this happened to him, he was strong before that. He was a fine looking man. And she used to sell cottage cheese and cream. She had a Jersey cow that had a world of cream on the milk. And she would sell cream and things like that. Milk. We were really poor.
Fort Sill.
Well, we've been all over it. We lived there when old Geronimo was there, and I was scary. I was afraid to go down. Sometimes we lived close to this little creek, and I was always afraid when I'd go down there by myself, if I'd go to hunt the cow or something. I was afraid that Geronimo would jump out of one of those trees on me. But but he never did.
Ever meet him?
I've seen him. Do you know that there were so many Comanche Indians down there in Lawton? And I'd see a woman come along with a papoose on her back in one of these little carryalls that they wore them on. And the man would come along behind her little piece and give the baby a little strip of raw beef, all bloody, and let him chew and suck on it. It used to just turn my stomach over. But he used to make, he'd beheaded so many women, or not beheaded them, but done so many things to the women, you know, with their hair and all, that he had a belt made out of it. And I don't know whether he scalped the women. He may have. He never did scalp me, but I was scared to death of him.
What is your fondest memory of your father?
His gentleness and his sweetness. And I never heard him speak that swear word but one time in all of my life. And he was just as gentle and sweet and kind as he could be. I can't remember that he ever scolded me, let alone hit me or anything. He never did. Or hardly either. I don't think he ever hit hardly. But he was good to us. He was awfully sweet and kind. But he would tell me lots of things that were interesting. Do you know that I got a good part of my education? I got some things you didn't get in the school books. But he would take me in this horse and buggy when we'd go out in the country to serve papers. And he would tell me things of his past, you know, and things that had happened. He told him, this was kind of nasty. A bunch of them, they used to go out and pick up these outlaws and all, and they'd bring them back, and they'd have to tie them up at night or do something with them, you know, to hold them. And they did it various ways. And there was one possuman that was with Papa, and he had an awful weak stomach. His stomach would just turn over at the falling of the leaf. And Papa got to telling some unrighteous tale of some kind, and just made this old boy sick. He just threw up his toes. And he would just get lots of kick out of doing things like that. And but there was one time that he was taking an old Indian in, and later on he was put to death for killing someone.
Yes.
And he was always kind to his prisoners. He never did abuse them or swear at them or anything like that. But he was taking these back to town, and they had them tied up to the wagon wheel and trees and all kinds of things. They had a pretty big turnout. And this Indian saw that he could get loose. And he had come to love my father. And he showed him that he could get loose. And so Papa tightened it up and fixed it so that he couldn't get away. And later on they hung him. And he felt bad about it.
What did Fort Sill look like in those early years?
Oh, there was just lots of these little buildings and things, you know, where the soldiers stayed. There's Fort Sill is still down there, and they have a museum there, old things, and it was interesting to me. We went in it and looked, and this same building that they used when Judge Iowa Bookham, Judge Parker here too. He was a real good friend of my father's, and down in the basement of this thing, they had a place to hold the prisoners, and it had, and it's still there, and it had, or did just a while back, it had a circle made out of cement, and it went, it circled this building down in the bottom there, and in days gone by, they had had it fixed so they could chain the prisoners. Fasten him to a chain to this seat, and the seat was part of the building, and that's where they kept them and held them. And then you went up the steps to go up. Have you been there? It's interesting. I put a few things there a time or two. And then you go up the steps, and they still have the same building that Judge Parker reigned over with his... He was a good man. He was supposed to be a Christian man.
Did you follow the work of Judge Parker?
Yes, a long time. And he had the highest opinion. This book tells about what a high opinion he had of my dad. And there was one time he told about what an ungodly amount of men Papa brought in at one time. And he said that he had brought in more men than any other possibleman or, I'm not trying to say, I'm lacking the word.
Marshal.
Huh? Well, you could call him a marshal. But anyway, that's what he was doing. He said he'd brought in more than any other man to the trial. And he would always, I've got a bunch of little leather books that he had used to keep track of things, and part of it was money, and part of it was prisoners, and part of it was things that he was after people for, and all kinds of things. And it's written in his handwriting, and I wouldn't take anything from him. I promised Llewellyn one of those, and I ought to get it out for him while we're still alive and have our senses. But they're very interesting, and he told in one about some hair dye, a hair dye recipe he had, and then something that came out. Did we read that just the other day? They were telling about this. Now, what did I read? And who was I talking to?
Bonnie.
Oh, yeah, Bonnie Spears is working on a book about my dad. She's working with me. But my aunt was coming to visit us, and he always liked Aunt Annie. She was real well-to-do and fun, and she was just nice. She lived in Tulsa, and she was married to an Indian. He didn't look like an Indian. He was a fine-looking man. But somebody shot into a keg of gunpowder and hit that gunpowder, and it knocked him back and hit his head on the back of the shelves, and it killed him. And he was a fine-looking man, and his wife was pregnant with their last baby at the time. They had two other children. But we all loved them, and she had a mansion in Tulsa. It was a beautiful house. After the town kind of moved away, she moved out of that, moved to another house. And some tramps would go in there and sleep in the bathtub and things. It was a mansion in the house. Great, big. I thought we were really good ones down there. I slept in that. But what did I start to tell you? Well, I forgot myself.
You're talking about hair dye.
Oh, Aunt Annie was coming. He wanted to look pretty. He was good looking. He was a good looking man. And he played more practical jokes on people than anybody I can do. I'll tell you about another one in a minute about a darky. But he played some practical jokes on this barber that he went to, and he got even with him this time because he knew Aunt Annie was coming, and he dyed his hair purple. Papa was gray. And what he was wanting was just a little tint, you know, just a little touch-up, make it a little darker. And as old as I am, I don't have gray hair, only just a little long. Mother didn't ever get so very gray either, but he was pretty gray. But, and he Papa didn't get to see this till he was through. But he let him see it. Oh, he was just horrified and sick and disgusted. And so he had somebody touch him up. I don't know what was that man. And he had a recipe for some hair dye in this one of these little books. I don't know which one it is. I don't remember, but I've read it. What was it about? Oh, there was a... Papa was real friendly and kind with darkies. See, he'd been raised with some of them.
Now, you said he had in the Civil War, he had the one with him as a courier?
Yeah, one with him, 12 years old. He was the same age he was. And he'd been playing with him all through his life. He was 12. They were both 12. And did I tell you about him stepping in these arms and legs?
Yes, ma'am.
just horrified me, because I'm skittish.
Let me back up. Any other stories about the Civil War?
His father was seriously hurt in the war. He had to come home and he died. I never did have single grandparents on his side. But I sure had a grandmother on my mother's side. Her, I didn't like her dad at all, or my husband. Not beautiful physically, but beautiful in the spirit. And I think she had as much to do with my life as anyone. And Mom used to let us dance and do things like that. I never was wild at it. Maybe it was higher. But I did take up dancing later on. I just loved it, but I quit when I came to the Lord. And it used to just worry my grandmother because she let us dance. I used to have some up there at my house, you know, just scoop waiting mates and things of that sort. Dance the Victrola. My mother used to say, grandmother used to say, Madie, you're just sending those girls on the high road to hell. I don't think dancing sent you to hell. I don't think it's that. I don't believe in doing it as a Christian. So I don't. I couldn't hardly get around the floor to go anyway. But my grandmother thought it was a great sin. But she came to see me baptized, not that I never went to.
Did you go through high school?
No, I didn't get through high school. I had to go to work when I was just off the bed.
What type of work did you do?
I worked for the Bell Telephone Company there. And it was called, it had that old-fashioned name. And I know if I could recall it. Maybe it isn't gonna come, I'm afraid. Maybe after you've gone, I think. Oh, we have a Pioneer Telephone Company. I worked with Pioneer.
How'd you get your job with the phone company if you were too young?
I went down and knocked on their door and knocked on their door and knocked on their door till they got tired of me. And I wasn't, I was a pretty good sized girl. I guess I was about as tall then as I am now. And you know that they took enough interest in me that the head lady, she was what they call
the supervisor.
No, I was a supervisor and I was a chief operator, and I was an evening chief operator first, and then I was a day chief operator, and that's getting that high. But the supervisor is under the chief operators. But the traffic chief is what I was called. I waited here for. The traffic chief was the head woman. And oh, she was a beautiful, beautiful woman with red hair. And she was interested enough that she and the chief operator came out to my house to talk to my mother to see how we were having to get along, you know. And mother rented a light housekeeping room, and that's just the poorest of poor. And we were in the midst of the Depression. Oil went down to $1 a barrel, and we were having a hard time to make the go round. My Aunt Annie had money, and I know that she's found of helping my mother some, but she didn't go overboard, I imagine. I don't know all about that, but I do know that we had to watch our pennies and nickels. And
let me ask, what were your duties at the phone company? What did you do? What were your duties at the phone company?
Well, to start with, I went to the school first. It was just so many weeks, you know, that, and I caught on to it right like that. It was easy for me. And I worked on the rural board. I loved that. It was more interesting, the country people, you know. And I used a different position and different everything. But I had this one, and I always wanted that position. That's the one I worked on when I worked on the board. But I didn't get to work there but a year, and they promoted me to a supervisor. That was doing pretty good. And it wasn't long until I got an evening chief operator's job. and that was getting out. And later I got the chief operator's job.
What was your salary in those days?
Oh, honey, it was just, it was off the board. I can remember, I don't remember which job this was now, it's been too long ago. But I know that we, that some of them only got 85 cents a day. You can't buy very much bread and beans for 85 cents, and I had to buy my clothes. I didn't have a lot of clothes. But I wasn't too bad a looking girl, and I'd do the best I could with what I had.
Did you make your own clothes?
No. Mama did. She couldn't sew to suit them. So finally I found a place where they, they called it a garment shop. I think that's what it was. And anyway, you could go and buy clothes at a discount. They weren't used, they were new clothes, but you could buy them at a discount. And so we'd, Harley and I just haunt that place. Every time they had something new come in, well, we'd go look. And so we kept respectable. But I got along good. I worked over about 200 girls. And some of them were middle-aged women. And some of them were young. There's some few younger than I was. But I got along good with people. Got along good with these girls.
What kind of telephones did you have?
Oh, we had this kind of a switchboard where they had it fixed by hundreds, and they would have so much and so many hundreds in each one of these blocks, and we had a plug-in on a cord, and we'd keep those at our desk and then plug them into this, we call it a jack, plug it into the jack. You'd answer down here below and plug in up there, and then you'd ring them with a key. Later on, we didn't have keys. They were automatic. You just plug them in. But I was working on the board for that. I only worked on the board about a year. And I'd only worked about a year on each thing that I was climbing up on. And eventually, I got the chief operator. And I was young then. I was awful young.
I had a question. I lost it.
We had lots of girls working up there.
In the early days, what did you do for recreation?
Well, you know, the war came along pretty quick, and we played with girls because the crop of men that were about were not the kind of type that you'd want to date. They were all too old or too young or not nice or something. I never went for them.
Did you do any work to support the war effort?
What?
Did you do any work to support the war effort? Like some of the women did it?
I rolled bandages for a while, but I didn't try to knit or anything like that.
Where did you roll the bandages? Where did you do this?
Red Cross.
At the Red Cross? At Lawton?
Tulsa.
In Tulsa?
No, I didn't work at the telephone office of Lawton. I did that in Tulsa. We went to Tulsa when Papa died.
What year did your father die?
1915.
And is he buried in Lawton?
Yeah. You know, we never had a stone put on his grave. I had been talking about doing that, and Aunt Annie, she was the one with money. She was always says, "Old Beth, if you're going to do anything for anybody, you ought to do for the living, not the dead." And she'd keep on that way, and so I didn't do anything about it. And finally somebody put something in the paper that they had found Heck Thomas's grave. Great day. Well, I knew where it was all the time. I'd been going out there. But Albert and I wrote to each other. He was the handsome one. Did you ever see his picture?
No.
He was as handsome as a Greek god, and I've got 100 letters in there from him. And I could have had 100 more if I'd have saved them. I've had a transplanted hip and stuff 3 times. Sometimes I wish you that. Hard win. that.
There it is.
Thank you. That came from her. This is Albert. He went to...
Is this your brother?
Middle brother. I had three. But this was the favorite one. I didn't meet the youngest one until I was 54 years old. Albert was handsome.
Yeah.
He was just as handsome as he could be. He was always sweet and good to me. He and I went in together and bought a little old marker. It's a little pink granite. And it wasn't expensive. He didn't have a lot of money, and he was old and sick and in bed. But he wanted to be in on it. And I told him all right if he wanted to. I just sent what he wanted to, and we'd get it. I didn't get it at that one because I wasn't rich either. But I sure did love that boy. Well, they're all a lot older than we are. I was just a little girl beside of him.
Is he still living?
No, he's dead. But they're all dead. And I got to see this youngest one. I went to Florida to see him. Thanks, and I took a trip down there. And I went down to see a woman to try to reach her for the Lord that I had worked with in the telephone company. And I knew that she never had come to the Lord, or I didn't think she had. So I went down there to talk to her and her husband. And after we'd seen them, we went on to down to where Loving lived. Well, I know where he lives. I still write to his wife once in a while, sent her Christmas card. I can't think of it now. His wife and the children are living down there. One of his son is an opera singer. I don't know what name he goes by. I never did write to him, I never did meet him. But I met the little girl, and she was just a beautiful girl.
Tell me about the trip from Lawton to Tulsa.
We rode a train, and we had to sell our furniture. We couldn't afford to move all that up there. And then we had to start over. Aunt Addie helped us. I know she did. She gave us things she didn't need.
Why'd you move to Tulsa?
Well, Aunt Addie and Grandma and Grandpa lived there. And Papa wanted us to be, she wanted Mama to be back with her folks. And so we moved back up there. She couldn't have made it there long, I don't think. She had this milk and stuff, but she couldn't have supported us for that. But we were poor.
Would you relate some more stories about your father that you can recall?
You want a little silly one?
Yes, ma'am.
I thought it was plain funny myself. He used his horse and buggy sometimes to take prisoners into the jail. And there was one old woman there. She had white hair. She was getting way up in years. And she'd get drunk every Saturday night. And this is another old thing I'm thinking of. But anyway, she would be in jail every Saturday night, and they were right under an overhead electrical light, and they got under that thing, and she laid her head over on my shoulder and said, "Oh, Hickey boy," and it just embarrassed him to death. And I called him that. He kept a letter that I had written him when he was in. He went to St. Anthony's Hospital when it was newly opened. That's where he went to find out about his heart. And I said, "Mr. Thomas, I'm awful sorry to tell you this, but said we don't have any cure for that. But they do now. And if you'd have had that now, they could have to." But, and he put, I started the letter off. He kept my letter. The dear Hickey boy. And I called him that a lot of the time, just kidded him. He liked it.
Why did your father become a marshal?
Do you know, he was planning to be a preacher, and I told you why he gave that up. He wouldn't do it. And he had a lot of push and drive in him. Oh, he's done some things that I just don't see how he could have ever done, you know, to when he was out bringing prisoners in and things. And he didn't like to kill anybody. He didn't ever kill any. He told me one thing. He never talked about his exploits to us, with the girls. He never told us about any of those things or about the people he'd had to kill. He said this one thing one time. He said, I never did kill anybody. I didn't have to kill. He would give them the first shot, and then he was a fast mover, and he'd move out of the way. When he killed Bill Doolin, you've seen that man with all these holes. He used one shotgun shell to kill him. But he gave Papa call to him. He was hiding out, and he called out to him and gave Bill Doolin the first shot. And he moved out of the way right quick. And he used that shotgun, took one shot, killed him.
Where'd that happen?
Huh?
Where did that happen?
I just can't remember for sure the name of it. I'd be guessing if I... I have a letter in here, in the scrapbook, that he took off Doolin's body after he died. From his wife, she was gone at the time. He'd been out running, you know, getting away, trying to get away. And Pop had been on his trail for a long time. And she told him there, that just told a little bit about, but there wasn't anything said about his death or anything, because he wasn't dead when she wrote it. She married, I don't want this in there, she married a man for a second husband that has my name. That is, I don't mean my given name. What was that, Luella, or Dorothy?
She married a man named Meeks. Meeks.
Was his name Meeks?
Mm-hmm.
Well, his name was almost identical with our initials and all, pretty close to. And, when Reno Madsen and his wife were over visiting us that night, and he just found out about it, they were living over at Bartlesville, and we still lived in Tulsa. And Reno told us what his name was and where he worked and everything, and he was dead, but where her husband did, I mean. And I just laughed out loud when he said it, because it was almost identical with our name. Ours was J.B. Meeks, and they just had one letter different in his name. But then he wasn't an outlaw. He was a working man. He worked for a living. And they talk about her being such a beautiful woman and him such a handsome man. He looked like the last rose of summer to me. Baby! Hey!
Any other stories about your father?
Huh?
Any other stories about your father you can recall?
Oh no, he didn't know Papa. See, he was Bill Doolin.
No, any other stories that you can recall about your father?
Oh Lord, they're just full of them, if I could just recall. If I'd have known exactly what you wanted, I might have been better prepared. Would you like to take a look at the scrapbook?
Yes, ma'am.
Dorothy, would you help me get it?
I'll get it. I'll help you sit
there. I'll help you when it's ready.
If I may, I'd like to maybe come back sometime. And
let me help you. Papa had a whole bunch of these, and they're worth their history. And I've given away, I gave one to the man at What am I trying to say down there?
Museum of the Great Plains in Lawton.
No, I don't think we gave him one, but we gave one to the judge. Judge Parker. I've got a book of Judge Parker's up there that he... I guess he sent it to Pop or I bought it. I don't know what.
Oh, in the museum of Judge Parker. That's what you're talking
about. Yeah, in the museum.
Yeah.
I gave one there and I gave one to this man that wrote the books, you know, Shirley.
Yeah.
Have you met him?
Glenn Shirley?
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Can you say the name on that? Bottom.
G. S. G. Victor. United States Marshal. Oh, Emmett Dalton's application.
Oh, you know, I was in the yard down there at Lawton when he came down to ask Papa for a job. After he'd been an outlaw with his brothers and the rest of them were all dead. And, he was just cowtown to Papa. And Papa just treated him very, very normal. But he told him that he couldn't. He couldn't go along with that. He wanted to be a marshal. And he turned him down. I can't read these plain enough to make them out anymore. Here's one from C. Madsen. I think that's a letter. Honey, no, that won't. Give me my magnifying glass, but not the big one.
Where it is.
I believe it's on that other table where I sat tonight. I can't make out hardly any of them anymore. I'm just getting like this lately. Hanging judge.
Oh yeah, Isaac Parker.
Here's a letter to my mother. Letter from Colin Monteith requesting regarding Doolin. No, this is a letter from Chris Madsen about Doolin. You know, he was awful Dutchy talking, but he was an educated man. He was an interesting. He'd been with the Foreign Legion and no telling what all.
Oh, I don't see it in there.
Don't you? It's that black flat one.
Yeah, but it's not on the
I table. Don't know where the little one is now, and it sure gives a better light than it. Here it is right here. I'm going to snake it a bit, mate. That new one isn't doing too much for me. Sure what that is. What this is it?
He could probably help you read that faster than you could do it yourself.
I know he could.
This is some Isaac Parker again.
Is it from Isaac Parker? Do you know he still has the same desk and chair that he used when he was the judge?
Oh, this is a letter stating that your father should be appointed U.S. Marshal.
Yeah, but he didn't get it. There's too much politics and things like that. Mm-hmm. And Papa was Democrat. Lord Ferguson's late last news tip brings the story of the early outlaw days. Walter Ferguson, I believe, did he live in Lawton? I can't remember. You see this picture on so many of the backs of a lot of things. That's supposed to be probably
yeah.
It didn't look like him. He was tall and slim. He was fat in one picture that I've got.
You really don't need me. I'm going to cut out.
Okay, sweetheart, you still got work to do.
I was like to talk to both of you if it'd be possible for us to get Xerox copies of some of the letters for the Historical Society. And know, we could, it would be easy if it's okay if you could bring him up with a copy of my thing and you can take it back.
I have a copy of Chief Mike.
Oh, you do?
My husband does. I'm
oh, okay.
Do that way.
Yeah.
Sure,
if
I
could.
Could.
Because there's one here that Isaac Parker wrote to Grover Cleveland, president, when he was asking that. Yeah.
And because I have the letter at home from Senator Gore.
Yeah.
Have that one.
That's
yes, ma'am.
The letter that was on Bill Dillon's body that was written when
yeah.
he was killed.
Because we do have a Heck Thomas collection. And we
there was
have
something else I was thinking about.
Now, we have his commission as U.S. Marshal.
I thought you had one.
Yes.
That's I have a lot of the
his ring was, he had a Masonic ring that was in the museum at one time and somebody stole it. The
yes,
museum.
They did. I remember that.
Boots makes you sick.
This was taken down there at the museum, the Great Plains, where they dedicated it.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I went down for it. Did you figure out what about that letter? That letter I had.
Oh, yeah, it's okay. It wasn't anything.
It isn't anything I need to turn to?
No, it wasn't. If you can just make a little stack of the things you'd like me to copy,
sure.
I'd be glad to do it.
Okay.
And I can just bring them to you or mail them to you or whatever.
Okay. What I'd like to do is come back and maybe do another session and, you know,
oh,
get some more stories that your mother remembers about. Yeah. Then we
and
give.
This always reminds her of more things
yeah. Okay.
Through the papers, too.
Well, it's a pleasure to meet you.
Well, it was nice to meet you, too.
Yeah, thank you.
Uh-huh, certainly. So you want to come back another time and find the papers that you'd like to have copied?
No, I can go through them now
that?
And then
okay.
come back another week or so and do another session, if that's okay.
Mm-hmm. As far as I know, I never know if one day or the next.
Okay.
Mother, he's just going to make a little stack of things he'd like for me to copy. And I'll take them out to the office and copy them and then send them to him.
All right.
So just,
and that
just
way
keep
we won't ever lose any of them.
Okay.
Yeah. Just put everything
you know,
else back
Mama
in there.
Mama had somebody just chip her out of a whole gob of pictures.
Yeah.
And she was blind too, you know. She had other troubles that caused her to be blind. This is where he was out there at that, I guess, where his grave was. I can't even see the stone there, but it's there. I guess my oldest brother was really, you know, there's an old brick building out here on your way to, as you go down this way. What is the closest town you go through when you're going down? I go to Ms. Langston's that way, or used to. You remember that seminary that's up on the hill that's back from the road? That's where
going
Henry
to
went
Valley.
To college, huh?
Going to Paul's Valley.
As you go to Paul's Valley. But this is before you get near that far. But that seminary is still up there on that hill.
Be down Highway 77.
And it's on, and it's the only thing that's up there.
So,
I'd love to see it because Henry went there.
I don't know. We can come up with it. Call me back.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. See you later, Mom.
Goodbye, sweetheart.
Bye.
That was just lucky. He was old and sick. You know, he lost his star, but he found it.
Oh, he did?
Somebody found it.
Do you have it?
No, I did have it. I'll tell you, it had, Mama had lots of physical troubles. And she was blind and had cancer and Lord knows what all. And she was short and heavy. And she just had everything. Well, she sold that star. And I didn't know she'd sold it. But she sold it to get money to help to pay their doctor. And, I heard, I wrote to the banker that had it at Lawton. And he says, I don't have it anymore. Says, I sold that, or I gave that to a man in Hollywood. And come to find out, it was a movie star that I've seen a lot of times. He said I wouldn't sell it, but said I would give it back. And let you get it where it can be used. And so they, this cowboy, he was using it, and he was riding in the things with that. But he sent it to us, and they sent it to me with the understanding that it would be given back to the museum. And yeah. I sent it right to the museum.
In Lawton.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. And I forget the man's name right now. He had a funny name, but I could recall it. It's in here somewhere, but I could recall it, I think. And I sent it back. And it's in that thing down there, that case. All right, Thomas. Hey, Thomas is very ill. The last thing he ever said to me, he reached over and pulled me over to him. I was standing there by his head. He called me, oh, he's called me Patty's baby. That was the last thing he said to me. He was the sweetest man I ever lived. It would take a pretty high-bred man to stack up to him after I'd been raised by him. Because he was the one that did the raising on me. She had the oddest disposition. She was well educated and had a great memory, but she... Mm-hmm.
Where'd your parents meet, do you know?
Huh?
How'd your parents meet, do you know?
She was teaching school there in Tulsa. And I'll tell you how he happened to meet her. Mama was running around with a girl. The doctor's daughter there. I did know the name. Maybe it had come to me, I think. And Mama ran with this girl, and she was down there to see this girl the day that they brought him in. He had tackled some outlaws, and oh my land, it was a heavy job. And they shot him, and he had a scar a fourth of the way around him here. And he had rode on horseback from a little town called Red Fork. Do you know where Red Fork is at Tulsa? Mm-hmm. Well, he'd rode from Red Fork into this doctor at Tulsa. And Mama met him the day that he entered the doctor's office. And he fell for her pretty quick. She was right attractive. And she was short, and she was fat as she got older. She had kind of reddish hair and green eyes. And he was attracted to her, but he was still married to this woman. But he got a divorce after that. I wouldn't want that to come out of the book. I don't know what I would want. But,
mm-hmm.
But she was down in Georgia with her folks. But they didn't marry for a good long time. And she never did marry again until after her husband died. I'll say that one out. She never married again until Papa died.
Yeah.
And then she didn't. Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry.
She married. She married again, but I don't know who he was or anything about him. You know the family. Now I've been friendly with the three boys. What I could be, and I didn't get to see them a whole lot, but they lived clear down the deep south. And Albert came more than anyone else. He just idolized his dad. And when he was young and growing up, Papa went down to the south. He'd already had it arranged and got Albert and brought him back, and he was going to hunt outlaws with him. He loved the kind of a life my father led. He fought with Roosevelt,
The Rough Riders?
Yes, he rode with Roosevelt, with
who
the Rough Riders,
who was
there.
What's his name?
Albert.
That's your brother?
That's my brother, my beautiful brother.
Yeah. Any stories that he told you about being with Roosevelt?
Huh?
Any stories that he told you about being with Roosevelt?
I don't remember whether he ever did or not. He didn't tell me so many stories. Well, he would tell me things about Papa. Papa used to pull. They were just terrible about pulling things on each other. Now that looked just exactly like him, more so than some of the other pictures there, but I can put my words for it. But I never had anybody love me like he did. Are we making a hell of a mess here? There's so much that it's hard to sieve it out. I haven't let much of it get away from me. But do you know my sister still feels a little bit bad, and her son feels downright bad because I got the book. But he'll never get it.
Yeah.
Because I'm going to keep it in the family. Well, he never did anything for her. And he was in the Army during part of it. There's lots of women outlaws in those days. Little Britches and I forget the names of most of them.
You ever seen Little Britches?
Yeah. No, I haven't. You mean have I ever seen her in person? No, I never have.
Any stories about her that you've heard?
Not that I can remember. Now there was, you know, I was looking for some papers for a man the other day. We have a family tree that goes way, way back. They came over here centuries ago. Papa, and we have all that stuff written down somewhere. And I was going to try to find them for this man, but he hasn't called me back, and I'm not going to hunt him for him if he don't care enough to come after him.
Yeah.
Marshal Thomas. He got a golden star, and he lost it out in the cow pasture one time. And it was gone for several years. And one day I was out there cleaning it out for him, raking up the hay and stuff and stuff. And my rake or whatever I was using, it clicked on something metal. I looked down there, it was that star with a diamond in it. And he was thrilled to death. I was so glad I could be the one who found it. Mama called him up and he came home. But he'll just run you crazy when he's in here.
What happened to this star, the one that you found?
I think, I told you we were poor. I think at one time that he sold it to the bank. Mm-hmm. And the bank and the town people had taken up money and bought this for him. And the banker that bought it had taken the diamond out and put it in a ring for his wife. It made me feel bad. And I guess they used the gold for...
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't think we're getting very far in this right here, do you? My mother was smart in some ways. What I started to tell you a little bit ago, his whole family were fighting in that war for the South.
They were. Mm-hmm.
So I still have a certain amount of, I wonder if we'd run across something about this. I can't make, here's something about, in here about, can you make out what that is? I can't see it. Read it.
Oh, the Battle of Atlanta. We'll commemorate the Battle of Atlanta.
I wonder what his name was, did it say?
General Edward Lloyd Thomas.
Edward Lloyd.
You say he's buried in Kiowa?
Huh?
You say he's buried in
there's
Kiowa?
There's one that is buried in Kiowa, and whether it's him, I don't know. But somewhere, somehow, I can find that eventually. And the big old fence that was around it, there was eight pieces of stone in this in this burial ground, and it had this wire fence, a heavy wire coming to around it, but it was degenerating and wearing out and about to fall down. I told some of the other family about it. I didn't have any way to get it. My husband was sick for a long time before he died. He wasn't able to get down there and do anything about that. Mm-hmm. But they had eight rocks in there, and no sign of a name on it, just this one cement thing. Now, it's still down there, I'm pretty certain. And you know, I think I could find it again. We hunted and hunted for 3 days. And I finally found it in the third cemetery we went to, and it was in Kiowa. We'd been to McAllister and Kiowa and another place.
Is that the city of Kiowa?
Uh-huh. It is much of a city.
Is that
it's near, a wide place
is that near McAllister?
It's close to McAllister.
And
I'll tell you, it seemed like the road ran in that direction. And when you go in then, here's another great big wider road that goes through the cemetery, and that goes right straight by his lot, mm-hmm. and his carries coffin.
Is there a name on the stone?
On his stone there is.
Is the name Thomas?
Yeah. And it has his given name on it too, but that's eluded me right now.
Is it Edward?
I don't remember. There's lots of Edwards in the family. But if I will eventually run across that thing that I've got. And I thought it was in those books, you know, of Kodak pictures. And I know that I have it in something. Mikey, you're not Mikey. You're D D D D. Mikey's the one that died. I'm slow to die over it. He's just been dead about 6 weeks. I lay down here on the floor with him. Now that's my sister, I believe. She's the fat one in the picture.
This one?
She's one of them. I believe she's the other one. Yeah. This was the girl she ran with. But this is Harley. She's very pretty when she was young. Mm-hmm. She wasn't fat then. She was pretty. She had a daughter or two that was right good looking, but the boy wasn't. But she had the hatefulest old husband. I never did like him. He didn't like me either. Oh, you found one with some pictures in it. If you see something with a fence around it. And they didn't have a name on any of these other graves.
They didn't?
No. They were probably servants. They lived in the time of servants. Papa did too. He played with the darky kids.
Oklahoma weather, December 1917.
Yeah. I was working at the telephone company there. I used to walk 2 ways, because it was 2 miles home. I'd walk 2 ways each day and ride the streetcar. I could ride to an echo. And I kept slim and trim doing it. I didn't ever get great big black my mother. There's off the bell. Bell Tillman.
Mm-hmm. How did he die, Bill Tillman?
He was shot. There was a man that dealt in liquor, and he was supposed to be a lawman and supposed to be controlling things like that. Mm-hmm. And he had 2 guns, and he was drunk and had a woman with him. And Uncle Bill took away the gun that he saw, but he didn't know that he had one down in his boot. And when Uncle Bill turned, he reached down in his boot and got that and shot him in the back. I thought, what a way for a man like that to end.
Mm-hmm.
I just loved him. There he is again. I wonder if that. Yeah, that's where he was shot. Shot to death in Cromwell. And we got the news right sudden, came over there. And Miss Hawkins that was killed there, and have you run across anything about Hawkins?
I don't think so.
He was 7 feet tall, and he was handsome and good and everything that was nice. And he worked for Papa there. Let me look at my green beans that just came to me when I saw Shot Hawkins. I'm good at doing that, forgetting them. I don't think I burned them, I can't smell them. But I lost my sense of smell when I had.
I don't smell anything.
Well, I like to roll over my head. Oh, baby. My son.
The little books.
Mm-hmm.
Are they in here?
They better be. Bill is looking after him more. That's Dorothy's husband. But she keeps an eye on things. And he wouldn't do anything with any of it. But I'm leaving it to them when I go. And I have not to be here too much longer.
Would you consider, you have three of these, of the commissions.
What?
You have three of the commissions here.
Oh, Lord, I have a lot more than that.
You do? Mm-hmm. Would you consider giving one to the museum in Oklahoma City?
I'll talk to Dorothy.
Okay.
Do you know we gave this beautiful ring of Papa's to them and somebody stole it? And we were just sick about it.
Yeah. The museum in Oklahoma City?
Uh-huh. I went down there, there's some others up so that went, and they didn't have any idea what happened to it. Somebody got it.
We have a commission like this, but we don't have one of these.
That's it.
We don't have
What is it like you've got?
We have one like this.
Yeah, his?
Yeah, but we don't have one like that.
This isn't his writing on it. He wrote it up ahead.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why they wrote so pretty and I wrote so often. I didn't go to school much, that's why. But the Lord has blessed me mightily. Do you know that I've taught people in church work, and I've taught that book from one end to the other, and I had a man in there that had a doctorate. Can you imagine that?
Huh.
I don't know whether he'd listen to me if he'd have known how little I had. But he listened to me. He came. Be there every Sunday night. And they let me teach whatever I wanted to out of the whole Bible. And I loved it. I didn't know about it. I had 62 men and women in there.
Hmm.
And I wasn't worthy to do all of that. How many commissions do you think he has all told in here now?
I'm sorry?
How many commissions do you think he has all told in here now?
I see four or five here.
Well, I was looking for those little books to see if they're in here. I'm pretty sure that they are.
Oh, here's another one.
Dorothy is my little mainstay in the family. Since her daddy died, she has really looked after me best she could. She's a real smart little girl. She and Bill got married on the run and didn't even tell us.
Anything else in here we could have copied that.
I would trust you. Or I would trust some people. Do you want a pillow to sit on?
Oh, no, this is fine, thank you.
Oh, honey, hush. I'm sorry. My oldest daughter has been living here with her for 12 years. She's moving to herself.
in about 3 or 4 months. And I can't see very good. I'm getting blonder and bad. I guess I'm going pretty blind. I don't know what I'm going to do.
Well, here's the part of a leather book.
Yeah.
That's the cover of it.
Yeah. These little leather books are smaller, and they're about like this.
Mm-hmm.
And he wrote in it with his own hand. And he could write with a real pretty hand. I let them take it over home for a good while. Did you know that Bill Tillman used to have this, passing of the Oklahoma outlaw motion picture he made? Mm. And this daughter of Chris Madsen's that's coming, she has some of that. I believe she has a copy, maybe.
Yeah.
I went to see this when Uncle Bill brought it to Tulsa. Did you know Uncle Bill had one boy that was in the penitentiary?
Yeah.
He did. I don't know whether there was more than one or not, but he was a problem. Bless his heart, he couldn't have it. Did you ever hear about what Al Jennings got when he robbed the train?
No.
A stalk of bananas and something else similar. Papa used to get a kick out of that. Where do you live?
I live in Lawton City.
There you are.
Mm-hmm.
And who is it you work for?
The Oklahoma Historical Society, the State Museum.
Yeah. Seen it, little leather books. Have you?
Okay, here's one right here.
Is there? Yeah, that's one. But there's some that are larger and plainer. Do you know there was some man in Oklahoma City when Mama was blind? And old and helpless. And he borrowed all of her pictures of the outlaws from her. He was going to copy them. And send hers back to her and give her so much money for his copies. She never heard of it again. I think my sister and I ought to get kicked all over town for not taking better care of her than that. And she just cried about it. Right. The dirty devil. I bet he's got them down here someplace now where...
Oh, yeah.
Where they're on display.
What? This is a photograph of what town? Is that Lawton?
No, that's Tulsa.
That's Tulsa.
Uh-huh. And they lived in a little house similar to these.
Mm-hmm.
She had, Grandma Gaffo had, four. Mama had a Hooper's U of a temper.
Oh, here's another one. I see another book over here.
Yeah, there's several of those. This is part of the museum, the Great Plains. I had a whole book of those. That's Reno Madsen, isn't it?
Heck Thomas and Henry Thomas.
Oh, it was it. I didn't see Berkeley. That's his oldest son.
Yeah.
Now this is a picture of what I was talking about that you could see down there at the museum.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Well, that's the part that he was in, his portion. And then they have others, and they just run these ribbons to the other,
mm-hmm.
the other officers. I knew a whole lot of these people down there. They're going to have us go down there. They want us to come down for a week sometime. I don't know whether I could cut a week or not. Does it say on the back of that, I reckon?
It's hard to read.
Yeah. But that one in the middle is Papa.
Yeah.
And I remember these two men's faces, but I can't remember their names. Can't read it. But I've got a whole pack of pictures of the museum that they took the day that we were down there to it. We had some kinfolks came from the south to it.
Yeah.
Huh. And Reno Madsen and his wife were there. And I believe Uncle Chris, I'm pretty sure Uncle Chris was there. They'll tell me it was gone. Uncle Chris was a very fine conversationalist. He could tell you stories of it. Do you know, he had been with the Foreign Legion, and he'd been with other armies and had to run from them and everything. He'd had an exciting life. That's Tulsa, I believe.
Mm-hmm. Oh, there's the Oklahoma Historical Society.
Not sure.
1932.
I used to go up to the place down there at the state. You know, we had some, have you ever seen those pictures of Papa and Madsen and Tillman? We had them all made by the same photographer at
yeah.
the same time.
Mm-hmm.
We had those made and had them framed and had a chain put from one to the other. And they used to have them hanging up there, but the last time I was there, they didn't have them up.
Oh.
She says that they moved things around. And they had that old Indian down there with the braids and dressed up like a wild Indian. And he claimed that he was an officer. He never was. They went through the stuff and he never had a commission. And what is it they call him? I know his name if I can remember.
I'm trying to think.
I am too, but I'm not having any luck. Well, I don't think that's right to show things like that if it isn't so.
No.
Henry was the one that went to this school out here.
Hmm.
And do you know, years and years and years ago, and I met those people, and the old lady that had been his sweetheart. I don't know if she's dead now. The band or bond or something. White bead is what it is, white bead. And that's where Henry went to school. He was a real fine man. He was a better man than Albert.
Mm-hmm. Oh, here's another photograph.
It's been through the war, hasn't it?
Heck Thomas, Al Goff, Henry Sigmund, and William Gentry. Colonel Hawkins.
Well, Colonel Hawkins, that big tall one there, he died at our house at Lawton. Somebody shot him, and it was wrong what he had done. Of course, to shoot him had been enough, but he had done Hawkins an injustice, and then he got out there and shot him, killed him.
Hmm.
And Papa had Hawkins brought right down to the house, and Mama took care of him till he died. And I had a beautiful little painting that I gave to Dorothy. She's got it hanging on her walls out there. She has a beautiful one. And Hawkins was engaged to a girl, and she painted that picture and sent it to my mother after he died. So it has a
a thought in the family.
Yeah.
But I just loved him. He just babied all of the kids. And I got a special amount because I was little. Yeah.
This is family history, looks like.
I'm disinterested. Dorothy's husband's a dentist.
Mm-hmm.
You know they're getting ready to take a trip to down where the darkies live.
They are.
Yeah, I wouldn't care anything about that trip. They traveled a lot. They'll see the wild animals and the colored people. I don't have things against colored people, but I don't pay them on the next one. I've got that much south with me.
Mm-hmm.
How many of those little books did you find?
I found both two.
I think I had about five. Some of them had disappeared. I think this is one right here. It is. It's a big one. You know, they kept expense money and trips and all kinds of things, and I drew pictures of this one, too. He never did stop me. Just little bitty kid things. Scrabble. Here's some of his writing, and I didn't hear what it was. I don't know what they let me tear them, mess them up for. I wouldn't have done it. A lot of this I can't make out a sort of fine writing up there. But there's a lot of stuff in it, I don't know what all it is. You know, you knew they had old Geronimo in jail down there for years at the
Chancellor.
Yeah. I never did want to see him. I was scared of him. Papa never did see that one man home. He said he never wanted to see another one. He felt bad about a lot of them.
Yeah.
You know, one time a bunch of desperados robbed two banks at one time. There was lots of people killed. The Daltons were in on that. A lot of them got killed. This Emmett came through the sleighing. I think the rest of, it seems to me like the rest of, just about all of them died.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just afraid to quote on a lot of things because it can't remind any stories it used to be. He tried to teach me to shoot. And I don't even have a gun here, but I think I ought to have one, don't you, if I stay alone?
Yeah.
I hate to do it. I wouldn't want to shoot anybody. But I won't have anything for protection but this one little bitty tiny dog, and he'll just make a racket. Llewellyn has a good-sized dog, but I won't have him when she's gone. I don't want him. Well, she wouldn't ever have him anyway. She and I don't see things eye to eye on many, many things. And she told me last night, said she loved me, but she didn't like me. So on that, I just went to bed. I've just helped her and helped her, let her live off me and everything for a long, long time. And then she waits until I can't see to. She has a good job, but I don't live off of her. I have only two.
Mm-hmm.
I've taken a lot of interest in those little books that he wrote in himself.
Would you consider letting me make some copies of these at the museum? I can bring them back tomorrow.
You mean the little books or just
the... Yeah, the little books also.
What I'll do to you if you don't have it, don't you?
You can skin me alive.
I'll skin me alive.
I'll bring them back as soon as I get them copied in the morning. And I'm going to Anadarko, and if I don't bring them back, I'll have Mr. Welby, the other archivist, and I'll have him bring them back tomorrow.
That's all these little books?
Yeah.
That's one of the things I love the most.
And I will give you my phone number, everything, and so you'll know exactly how to get a hold of it.
You know that all I've got left in my dad is what he left me. This and what he left in my heart. And I idolized him.
This empty photograph of Tulsa.
I wish I'd have found that Tulsa book. I don't know what I've done with it. It wasn't so interesting, really. But I did find the pastor in there that I joined the Methodist Church first, but I didn't stay with it. I joined the Baptist.
Mm-hmm.
And I've stayed with it ever since. Isn't it nice to be young and spry and able to sit around on the floor?
Well, I'm not so young anymore.
You're pretty young in my book. I just thought, hated to be 89. I actually wrote another book.
Mm-hmm.
My sister's 91.
She is.
Uh-huh. Bless her heart, she doesn't look as good as she looks in that picture.
She doesn't.
No. But I thought it was a good picture, and I was glad she had it. She sent me another one.
I'm supposed to go interview her sometime next week.
Oh, are you?
Mm-hmm.
We're different turned people.
You are.
Uh-huh. Completely. You know what she did one time? When she was a little bitty thing, this don't have anything to do with outlaws. There was a man came by our house, and he was trying to sell things. And he came to the door, and Mama hid. And Harley went to the door. She said, my mama hiding from you. You want to see where mama hiding? And the fellow laughed and said, yes. So she went in there and opened the closet door and opened and says, see there, mama. She wanted to kill her. Aw, baby, be still. I thought it was kind of funny. One time she set me up on a chair and mama was down milking the cow. And she put me on the chair so she could watch us from down in the backyard.
Mm-hmm.
And Harley got the scissors and just cut me. Oh, she just cut my hair down. But she didn't poke my eyes out. And that's what Mama was scared about. She liked a broken neck getting up there. Oh, don't cry. I don't know whether Dorothy was going back to the office, if she's going home or what. Since these are will to them, I'll ask her. And if she'll go along with me.
Okay.
I'll on your word of honor, I'll let you come in. But if you don't bring them back, I'll hunt you down and kill you.
Yes.
With a great big butcher knife. My old bones are about to give away. I got me one of these things with a magnifying glass on it that I can pull down and see this, but it doesn't do too much good. I think I'm going to go clear blind. Mother was.
Oh,
that's all right. I just had my shoe against it. I hope I don't fall on this thing.
Get that out of
just way. Let me hold off. I get over it. I wasn't strong-holding it.